Shall we begin with a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace, petitioning you for an understanding today, an understanding of a vital point, the fourth angel. Father, we claim the promise where Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in his name, that he would be here in our midst. And so, Father, we thank you for that promise. Lord, I pray that you will send the indwelling Christ to be within each and every one of us, that we may hear and understand that which you would have us to know and understand. Father, I pray that you would touch my lips with a coal from off your altar, that I may present your words, your tone of voice, your body language, everything that presents your thoughts in love. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I begin, I'm going to have four or five quotes. I'm going to have a few quotes from the Daniel and the Revelation. And if you haven't read it, then you haven't begun to understand prophecy. You need to start with the Daniel and the Revelation. And from there, if you want to expand and dig deeper, then do so. But this is what you want to stand or start with. And I'll be quoting specifically from this one, which is the 1912. There have been some changes made here and there, but for the most part, the quotes that I will be sharing should be found in pretty much every one of them. Now, what I want to do in Revelation chapter 18 is I want to look at three points. Look at three points. And point number one is we're going to show some identifying characteristics or ways to identify who Revelation 18 is speaking about. Does that make sense? We don't want to be a part of the condemnation or the denunciation of Revelation 18, do we? No. No, the Daniel and the Revelation.
Sorry, I misheard.
1912. That's the copy that I've got that I'll be quoting out of. So we're going to look at three points. How to identify who is being spoken of in Revelation 18. And then we're going to identify and look at additional things that are mentioned. And we're going to talk about why there are additional things mentioned. And then point number three, and this point is oftentimes debated among us, when does this message start? When does this message start? So the three points, we're going to identify or learn how to identify who is included in the fourth angel. We're going to look at additional information that the fourth angel brings to us. And then we're going to identify the time frame of this message by God's grace. So if you will, open up with me to Revelation chapter 18. And again, I'm not going to go through the whole chapter. But I want to read a few of these verses for a background so that we understand or see what is being spoken of here. Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1, "And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried weakly, mightily," just making sure everyone's following along, "he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the Great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." I want to stop there for just a moment. You notice it says, mightily with a strong voice. This is denoting urgency. It's denoting power in the message. It's denoting what is going on as a revelation that Jesus is coming soon. So we need to be ready. And we need to be sure that we're not a part of anything that is denounced in Revelation 18. Does that make sense? God is giving a strong message to warn us. This is not something weak. This is something He takes serious, and so should we. Amen? Verse 3, "For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies." And verse 4, "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues." We'll stop there for just a moment. Being a part of Babylon in Revelation 18, even if we've got the right theology or the right heart, the road to hell is paved with good intentions, is it not?
Yes.
We ever heard that before?
Yes. Yes.
We do not want to be a part of the system in any way, shape, or form. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Because if we are a part of it, even if we've got the right intentions, if we're a part of it, we receive those plagues.
Hmm.
Can you see that in verse 4?
Hmm.
That's a powerful thought. I want people to recognize that. This is serious. This is very serious. Sometimes this message gets pushed down because some people may not like it. But it's serious. Verse 5, "For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." Verse 6, "Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her works. In the cup which she has filled, fill to her double." That's powerful. I want to stop there. Let's go into this a little deeper now. Early Writings 277. You know, early writings, every time I'm studying, early writings may not be my personal favorite. I like Gospel Workers and Desire of Ages. But every time I'm studying, early writings keeps coming up. You know, that's one of the books that I would highly recommend everyone read. Know it. Because it keeps popping up. There's a lot of powerful information there. And here we're told, "I saw angels hurrying to and fro in heaven, descending to the earth and again ascending to heaven, preparing for the fulfillment of some important event." So there's something, there's a preparation going on for an important event. Don't you think that would make this message important? Absolutely. "Then I saw another angel, another mighty angel, commissioned to descend to the earth, to unite his voice with the third angel and give power and force to his message." So here we see power and force being added to the third angel's message. Shall we say the latter rain is pouring out with the fourth angel? This is a final message to prepare God's people. "Great power and glory were imparted to the angel. And as he descended, the earth was lightened with his glory. The light which attended this angel penetrated," how far?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. "As he cried mightily," there that is again. You'll notice there's a consistent theme. Strong, might, power, glory. You see that? Keeps coming up. "With a strong voice," there's that again. "Babylon the Great has fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird." The message of the fall of Babylon, as given by the second angel, is repeated with the additional mention of the corruptions which have been entering the churches since 1844. And now I'm going to finish the statement. I hate it when people take just one sentence and try to shove it down your throat. You want to see the context, amen?
Amen.
"The work of this angel comes in at the right time to join in the last great work of the third angel's message as it swells to a loud cry." Notice that. It is not an overnight thing. It's not like yesterday you didn't hear anything about it and today all of a sudden, boom, it's everywhere. It is a swelling process. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So that means it starts small and grows.
Yes.
Do we want to wait until it's at full height before we join? No, we don't want to wait. We want to join in as soon as it's time. Amen? So the work of this angel comes in at the right time to join the last great work of the third angel's message as it swells to a loud cry. And the people of God are thus prepared to stand in the hour of temptation. This is a preparing message, which they are soon to meet. I saw a great light resting upon them, and they united to fearlessly proclaim the third angel's message. Now, obviously, there's a lot more than just what I'm going to present today that is found in the fourth angel's message. Righteousness by faith can be found in the fourth angel's message. There are many things that can be found in the fourth angel's message, but I want to zero in on one particular point. The sentence that I want to draw attention to is this. The message of the fall of Babylon, as given by the second angel, is repeated with the what?
Additional
mention of the corruptions which have been entering the church.
Churches
since 1844. Notice it is not one church. Church is what?
Plural.
That means, does that mean three? No, that doesn't necessarily mean three. Some people confuse plurality with meaning three. Plural simply means more than one. Does it tell us how many?
No,
it doesn't tell us how many. So we have to identify them. It doesn't say there's 100 or there's 3 or there's 500. It just says that there's more than one. This obviously means that it's not just dealing with the church singular of Revelation 17, the mother. It's obviously not just dealing with that system.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
That means it's getting closer to home. How close does it get? That's what we're going to find out. How close does it get? Let's go to Revelation 17, verse 5. We can find some information there in Revelation chapter 17. Revelation chapter 17 and verse 5. And upon her head was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Mystery. Babylon. What does Babylon mean? It means mixing, right? Specifically, the mixing of truth and error. Okay? And so it's not just a mixing of truth and error. It's not just confusion, but it's great confusion. And there's a central doctrine that is the mystery that creates all this confusion. And I think we all know what that doctrine is, right? But notice that she's the mother of harlots. That means there's more than just one involved, isn't there? She has daughters. So the question I ask is, how do you know which ones are the daughters and which ones are not? There's hundreds, thousands of churches out there that claim to be Christian. Amen, right? Does this make sense? We see them all over the place. I mean, Baptists. Somebody says Baptist, you got to ask which Baptist.
Yes.
There's this Baptist and that Baptist and this Baptist and that Baptist, right? Mm-hmm. There's all kinds of them. So which of these denominations are a daughter? Well, daughters have identifying marks of the mother, don't they?
Yes.
So anybody who knows my wife and her mother, they look at them and say, you're definitely mother-daughter. Why? Because my wife looks like her mother. Very strongly, she looks like her mother. She has identifying marks that were passed down from her mother. Now, does she have some identifying marks that came from her father?
Possibly.
Yes, but not as many as most children would. Most children are generally a blend. But she looks a lot more like her mother than her father. There are identifying marks, and it may be the mother's nose, or the mother's eyes, or the hair, or the cheekbones, or the skin. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But there's usually something you can look at the daughter and look at the mother and say, oh yeah, I see this. I see the resemblance. Now again, some daughters may resemble the fathers more than the mother, but they still will carry some resemblance over. Just like some churches may resemble the mother more than other churches.
Yes.
There are other churches that have more resemblance of our Father in heaven in them.
Yes.
They may have a right understanding of the state of the dead. They may have a right understanding of baptism. These are characteristics of the Father that they have taken on.
But
do they have any resemblance to Revelation 17? Yesterday we went over only two of some identifying marks of the mother. We looked at blasphemy and abominations. Just those two. If you'll just take a moment and just think about just those two identifying marks, ask yourself, do I know any churches that have taken these marks on? If so, then you know what you're looking at?
Daughter.
A daughter. You are looking at a daughter. How do I know that she's a daughter? Because she has taken some of the characteristics of the mother. Does that make sense?
Yes.
In the DNR, page 709, it says, Babylon is a term which embraces not only the Roman Catholic Church, but religious bodies, plural, which have sprung from her, bringing many of her errors and traditions along with them. These are identifying marks that they have taken from their mother. Now, again, they may have many of the marks of the Father in heaven, but they've still got some identifying marks of the mother. So who is their mother? Their mother is still Babylon the Great. In fact, if you go to Great Controversy, page 383, you'll find a definition of Babylon fallen that is crystal clear. And it says any religious body that has become, that was once pure and has become corrupt. It's any religious body that was once pure and has become corrupt. It's a pretty clear definition. That whole section there helps in identifying, which we're not going to go into those today. But there's more than one. That is the point I'm getting to. On page 709 also, he says, the fall is therefore a moral one, and he gives evidence, and I suggest you read them. For the result of it is that Babylon becomes a habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. These are terrible descriptions of what?
Apostasy.
Apostasy. Friends, if it's a daughter, it is what? Apostate. Do we want to be a part of that?
No.
I don't. I don't want to be a part of that. So I'm going to give a quick summary. Summary of point number one. Babylon refers really to any church that has an identifying mark of the mother. Mm-hmm. There's more than one. Church is. So all we have to do, God doesn't have to say, oh, be careful of this religion and this religion and this religion and this one and this one and this one and this one and this one. He doesn't have to do that. He just simply gives us the marks of identification, and then we know. That way, if another one pops up that he didn't list, all we have to do is look. Does it have a mark of the mother or not? It's as simple as that. So with that now, I want to look at another part of her statement. The additional mention. And she, remember, she says, the message of the fall of Babylon, as given by the second angel, is repeated with the additional mention of the corruptions which have been entering the churches since 1844. Once the first angel begins, it's to continue on, right? I think, have we all read those quotes? Once that first angel begins, it does not cease. It continues on. And after the first angel begins, there's a time in which the second angel began, and then it continues on, right? And then there's a third angel that's given, and it's already begun, and it continues on to the second coming, obviously, because the fourth angel adds power and glory to the third.
That's right.
So these things continue on, right? That's the intent, that they continue on. But I have a question. If the second angel continued on without cessation, then how could the fourth angel give anything new? Because the second angel already would have said, this is a sin, this is a sin, this is a sin. The fourth angel would come along and say, this is a sin, this is a sin, this is a sin. And the second angel would say, I already said that. You've added nothing new. Does that make sense? Something happens. Something happens.
More powerful way.
So if the second angel continued on without cessation, then there wouldn't be anything to add because the second would have already proclaimed them. It seems to me that the language indicates that somewhere along the way, the second angel's message stopped being proclaimed. Now, does that mean that God does not have a people that have that are proclaiming? Of course, he's got a people that are proclaiming. But I liked how Brother Thomas mentioned yesterday that, how did you say it again? With the horses? Okay. I was trying to remember this, and I'm so terrible with memorizing.
Predominant feature.
Predominant, thank you. This, when he was talking about the horses and the horsemen, he was saying that this, just because the horse is black does not mean that God does not have a people that are proclaiming the truth. What he's saying is that this is the predominant feature at the time. So it does not mean just because that the second angel ceased to be proclaimed, it does not mean that there is not a people proclaiming it. It means that the dominant feature at the time has stopped proclaiming. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So the voice of those that are proclaiming it are being drowned out by the voice of those that are saying, that's not true. Mm-hmm. But you know what? They're having to contend with it now. Mm-hmm. Because the voice is getting louder.
Yeah. Swelling.
Yeah. It is swelling. And as a result, it is causing a stir. This voice is swelling and they're having to contend with it and they don't like it. So if the sins of Babylon have stopped being proclaimed by a group of people, then it's probably because that group has joined Babylon in their sins. So if I'm constantly proclaiming, don't go into the bar and drink, don't go into the bar and drink, don't do this, and I all of a sudden I stop. There are many things that could make me stop. But one thing that will surely make me stop proclaiming that message is if I'm found in the bar drinking. Mm-hmm. Why would I want to point out someone's sins that point back at me? Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to do that. Mm-hmm. So what do? You stop proclaiming it. If they were giving the marks that we looked at yesterday, and they were proclaiming them, then people would say one of two things. Either you're a hypocrite because you're saying don't do this, but you're doing it. Or they would say, I see it, that's truth, and I'm not joining because that's what you're doing. So the best way to deal with that is don't say anything. Don't lead people to that. Does that make sense? And so this is why the second angel's message seems to have stopped. The predominant movement, the predominant group, has stopped proclaiming it, and they're drowning out the few. No more. Daniel in Revelation, page 710. These, he's talking about Protestants, started out on reform. They ran well for a season and had the approbation of God. But fencing themselves out about with creeds, they have fencing themselves out about with what?
Creeds.
They have failed to keep pace with the advancing light of prophetic truth. So what he's talking about is he's talking about a group of people that have started here and they're moving forward, but they stop. And they fence themselves out about with creeds. But since the writing of this book, there has been another group of people that continued on. They stopped and started backtracking. They have fenced themselves about with creeds. Why? Why do they do this? Because, friends, it is the Holy Spirit that is the binder of the body of Christ. It is the Holy Spirit that binds each and every one of us together. And when you stop advancing in light and you start backtracking, is the Spirit there? No, the Spirit's gone. So how do you keep that group together?
Creed.
You have to fence them in with creeds.
Mm-hmm.
That is the only way to do it. Now you have to substitute the Holy Spirit for creeds to keep the thing held together. So that applies as well. Either way, you have creeds. So he continues, and hence have been left in a position where they will finally develop a character as evil and odious in the sight of God, as that of the church from which they first withdrew as dissenters or reformers. And I add, as Protestants. They have ceased being protesters, which means they are now apostate protesters. They're no longer reforming or dissenting. He says they brought in creeds, like the 28 fundamental beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
Are not those creeds?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Have not many of us run into those, that fence
mm-hmm.
of creeds?
Mm-hmm.
He says that they will finally develop a character as evil and odious in the sight of God as that of the church from which they first withdrew as dissenters or reformers. That church is the Catholic system. What happened during the Dark Ages? Was that a good character or an evil character?
Evil.
An evil character, a character of persecution, of oppression. So they will begin to take on these character traits. Like the trademark lawsuits?
Hmm.
Yes.
Is not that very similar?
Yes.
Throwing people in jail?
Yes. They
just haven't started torturing like they did in the Dark Ages, at least to my knowledge. I don't think that's going on. I don't know. But, friends, these are a taste of the evil character. Is this where it's going to stop? No. We know that it's going to continue on and get worse and worse. It's going to swell. And likewise, the counter message of the fourth angel will swell with it. As the oppression increases, so also will the message that speaks against it. This is why it swells. This is part of why it swells. Friends, if Uriah Smith were alive today, he would have to rewrite the section on the fourth angel to include these sins. Bottom line, he would have to rewrite to include these sins. These are additional to the time when the second angel stopped being proclaimed. These are additions. I want to touch on just a few of them. In 1922, accreditation was approved in the area of medicine. Look at what's so-called Seventh-day Adventist hospitals. What's the difference between them and the church and the hospitals of the world?
Nothing.
Abortion is the same too. Now tell me, how can that be anything other than the world?
Mm-hmm.
You know, most of these, I have a friend that works in, I'll just leave it, works in one of the big hospitals. You know, they don't even play 3ABN in there. This is an SDA hospital. They won't even play 3ABN.
What does that work with?
What's that?
What does the last work is
in?
3ABN. Three Angels Broadcasting Network. In 1929, accreditation was accepted in the educational system. Oh, this one gets me. Now, most SDA teachers at SDA colleges and universities would get higher degrees from Babylonian universities and be trained by Jesuit thinking teachers. You know, Hitler said, if I control the books, I'll control the people. You know what he meant by that? I control what the students learn, and I will control the people. This is exactly what the devil has done. He's controlled what the students are being taught So what does that mean? It means he's got the people now in the palm of his hand.
Yes, he does.
Because they're trained with what he wants them to know. Mm-hmm. You notice Jesus didn't go to their schools.
Right.
How knoweth this man letters? He didn't go to their schools. The bottom line, I could spend hours on this one alone. But if you control the students, you teach them in the theology majors, and what are they going to do? They're going to teach that which they taught, were taught.
Yes.
They don't have to be Jesuits.
No.
They just have to learn from Jesuits.
Exactly.
They don't even have to know they're learning from Jesuits.
Right.
People tend to repeat that which they've heard without checking it.
That's right.
So each and every one of us should check everything,
right,
even if it comes from behind this pulpit here at Smyrna. It needs to be checked. Not only that, but we need to know it for ourselves. So I'm hoping to present enough information to get things rolling in your head, not for you just to take it to believe it, but for you to get, for things to get rolling in your head so that you go search it and see if it is true. You know, the Bereans checked Paul. If anybody should not have to be checked, it was Paul. But God gave him approbation for checking Paul.
Yes.
So we should check everyone. In 1955 and 56, I think we're all familiar with this date, during the meetings with the evangelicals, Martin and Barnhouse, the SDA Church traded away some vital biblical truths of Adventism for some Catholic doctrines in order to be accepted by the Daughters of Babylon. The Trinity, the nature of Christ, the single atonement. And you know, if we have taken on one of the marks of Babylon, one of the marks of Babylon is original sin. Think about that. Brothers and sisters, this is not just in corporate Adventism. The devil is making inroads into our movement. And we want to be careful. We want to check everything that is said. Even the small words that can be twisted and confusing. We want to know what they mean by that word. What do you mean? Because people can use a word that sounds good and it's biblical, but put a different definition to it and thereby lead astray simply by redefining one word wrongly. So we want to be careful. 1962 to 1964, the Vatican II Ecumenical Council held in Rome, the SDA Church sent Arthur S. Maxwell as an observer. Upon his return, he called for the scrapping of the old evangelistic sermons on the papacy and a completely new approach, the Great Hoax, or the Great Hope. Have you heard of that book?
Yeah.
I call it the Great Hoax. Why? Because pretty much everything pertaining to the papacy has been taken out. Where did that come from? There are many other things there. Also observing at Vatican II was B.B. Beach. Anybody who studied the history is going to recognize this name as well.
That's right.
This is probably secondary to L.E. Froom. I noticed Brother J.C. mentioned L.E. Froom, and I heard all kinds of people, oh. Well, that's because his name has become infamous, right? B.B. Beach is probably right below that.
That's right.
So he became friends with Catholic and World Council of Churches leaders there. He set up the first meetings between the World Council of Churches and SDAs, which took place from 1969 to 1973. He also wrote a book with the World Council of Churches called So Much in Common.
Mercy.
You know, the devil, if you just listen, the devil will tell on himself.
Yes.
L.E. Froom, may I here make a frank, personal confession? Every time, oh, what's this? So much in common. Telltale. In 1960s, the ABC's bookstores start selling Babylonian books. Can you see the downward slide?
Yeah.
1974, Samuel Bakayoki graduates from the Pontifical Gregorian University, a Jesuit university, in Rome. Where does he go? What does the Seventh-day Adventist Church do with him?
Hire.
They put him right straight into the seminary to teach the students.
Yes.
Do you think he's going to be teaching them truth?
No.
Not from where he came from. In fact, he received a medal from the Pope. And he graduated summa cum laude. You know, I don't think that's anything to brag about.
No.
I would keep that quiet. But may I here make a frank personal confession. The devil tells on himself. And if you want more, I believe B.G. Wilkinson, no, he doesn't go into detail in his book, Truth Triumphant. But there are stories of B.G. Wilkinson finding Jesuits even in his time and pointing them out, and of course, poof, they're gone the next day once they're revealed. You also find Jesuits in the writings of Ellen White that were trying to come in, and Ellen White warned about them. And as soon as the warning was given, they were gone. So this is nothing new. There's nothing new under the sun. In 1977, there's this name again, B.B. Beach places a gold medal representing the SDA Church into the hand of the Pope, showing friendship. Now, how can you be friends with the man of sin unless you are in some way following the man of sin? Can two walk together lest they be agreed?
It's treason.
It is treason. It's high treason. In 1979, the SDA Church's Ministry Magazine, I noticed Brother J.C., I think, quoted from Ministry Magazine earlier. Mm-hmm. Why do we get so many good quotes from this? It tells us. Mm-hmm. It goes ecumenical, and it's dedicated, quote, dedicated to stimulate supportive dialogue among denominations. More issues are sent to ministers from non-SDA denominations than to SDA ministers. And I wouldn't have a problem with that if it was proclaiming truth, but it's not. It's proclaiming ecumenism. This is why we find so many quotes revealing what they're doing in that magazine. 1980 to 81, the Trinity concept of God enters the official statement of beliefs. Now, I want to make a statement here. They were just as official in the 50s with the QOD, Questions on Doctrine. Sometimes people say, oh, it was official in 81. Oh, it was official in the 50s. Yes, right. They just finally made the public proclamation in the statement of beliefs. But it was just as official in the 50s. In 81, this one gets me going too. In 1980, oh, they all do, but there's a couple that are specific. In 1981, the hijacked General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists trademarked the name Seventh-day Adventist under commercial law using a Catholic lawyer, Vincent Ramick. Remember, the beast had committed unlawful interaction with the state? This is definitely unlawful interaction going on. So the General Conference, now a business entity, not a church,
That's right. A
business entity, uses civil power to sue small independent SDA congregations who use the term SDA illegally according to commercial law. This is the church using the long arm of the state to enforce its decrees and dogmas. Now, do I agree with all the churches that they were suing? No, I don't necessarily agree with their theology, but I disagree with how they dealt with it. 100%. By the way, where do you think they get the money for this?
From us.
Comes from the general fund.
That's right.
Where does the general fund come from?
Tithe.
They are using God's tithe money to sue people and to throw them in jail. There is going to be an accountability. And I don't want to be anywhere near that system when that accountability falls upon it. In 1985, a hymnal with false theology was received into the SDA Church. It contains 18 new hymns to the Trinity, never found before in an Adventist hymnal. We could go on with this one as well. There's many other things in that hymnal. But I'm pointing out a series, some sliding. You see the backsliding going on? In 1990, B.B. Beach unashamedly introduced the World Council of Churches President J. Campbell to the fifth business meeting of the General Conference session in Indianapolis, Indiana. And he said, I bring you the warmest of greetings from the World Council of Churches. Later he says, so as fellow Christians, like those Pentecost people, thought that was odd, but like those Pentecost people in the earliest of days, we look at one another and we say that we hold all things in common.
Yeah.
You hear the devil telling on himself? The next day, B.B. Beach introduces another one of his friends, A. Lee, to the sixth business meeting, who said, a number of us are here because of the invitation of B.B. Beach. He is also a secretary of a group to which both of us belong, namely the Secretary of Christian World Communions. Why would the corporate church be a part of this? It's just a question. He says, I pray God's richest blessings on this great conference, for truly it is good and pleasant to dwell together in
unity.
In the ninth business meeting, he escorted, and I'm, for those that are listening, air quoting, Father Thomas Murphy, who represented the Pontifical Council for Promoting Christian Unity, who was there to give greetings on behalf of the Catholic Church. Why would the Catholic Church send greetings to the one that's pointing out its errors? It wouldn't. What's that?
They're not.
Exactly. To the business meeting of the church system that was raised up to preach the third angel's message. This is what he says. He's proclaiming something to them. He proclaimed that the Catholic system was praying for the success of this general conference so that the prayer of Christ that we all might be one might be fulfilled. Are we ever to be one with the man of sin?
No.
I think not. In 1995, the Vatican flag, the Vatican flag marches into the general conference as part of the family of God.
Yes, they did.
They did. Right down the center aisle. I'm sorry. I think not. My religion, my church, would have nothing to do with that. I think we would all stand in protest. I would. I couldn't take that. In 96, SDA Hospital merges with Catholic Hospital in Boulder, Colorado. I've got a lot more information on that. In 1998, SDA signed an agreement with the Fallen Lutheran Church System that says we agree on Trinity and justification by faith. Well, they may agree on the Trinity and their version of justification by faith, but it's not the Bible version. You can't have justification by faith and a Trinity at the same time. In 1999, the Polish SDA Church signs agreement with the Roman Catholic Church after 15 years of discussion. We, SDA Church, teach Catholic doctrine. We teach Catholic doctrine, especially the Blessed Trinity, is what is evidently said in that document. In 2000 to 2002, the SDA Church held ecumenical dialogues with the Catholic Church. What came of it, I don't know, but I don't care.
That's right.
You don't hold ecumenical dialogues with the man of sin, period. It doesn't matter what comes of it as far as I'm concerned. Just the fact that you're entering into that is enough for me. In 2007, SDAs and Catholics participate and worship together at the Global Christian Forum World Meeting in Nairobi, Kenya. Can two walk together, except they be agreed? So, we see that there's more than one church being spoken of in Revelation 18. It's churches, it's plural. And we see by the marks who is a daughter, by the character traits and the theologies they've brought away. Does that make sense? All we have to do is look. God doesn't have to say specifically names. All we have to do is look. Uriah Smith would rewrite this book to include these. From what I know of Uriah Smith, he would not sit quietly. So let's look at the timing of the message. This one is more heavily debated amongst us. More heavily debated. But I want to put something forth from Uriah Smith that struck me like thunder. Timing of the message. About 12 years ago, I was threatened. I've not really said this publicly much, individually yes, but I was threatened with jail if I spoke on the truth about God. I used to work for the conference. I quit the conference, not over this issue. I hadn't even figured this one out yet. It was tithe and the politics. Politics got in the way of the gospel. And when the politics got in the way of the gospel, I said goodbye to the check. I don't care. I'm not here for a check. I'm here to spread the gospel. And so I left. I became the head elder of one of the churches that I had there. And that's when I started to learn, you know, the truth about God, is after I said yes to that, which brought about a whole thing in the church. It was not my intention at that time to do that. But the conference heard about it. My previous boss, the ministerial director, calls me and he threatens me with jail because he said, that is not public property, that is private property. We dictate who speaks there and who does not. And if you're on private property, you know what happens. I was like, of course I was young, scared to death. The way he worded it though, I'll just put it this way, the way he worded it, I either had to deny my faith or I had to stand for the truth. Yes. Anybody who knows me knows what I did. Of course, they did not put me in jail. Sometimes I look back and I wish they would have, because it would have made me a martyr. But they didn't. But the fact is, they threatened me with it. And I talked to another member later. And I brought this up and he says, yeah, he told me that he told you that. So he didn't just tell me this. He told another church member what he told me. Would you say that's severe?
Yes.
We're all in agreement? That's severe?
Yes.
I think it's severe.
Yes.
What about others who are standing on the fundamental principles and who have similar stories? Mm-hmm. I'm not the only one. Mm-hmm. I've heard many stories. Others very similar. Jail threatened even. I'm not the only one with that one. What about those who have been sued by the corporate system because they don't buy into their decrees and dogmas? Who have been fined by the long arm of the law to the extent that they're shut down? Do you think that's severe?
Yeah.
I think that's severe. What about those who have been thrown into jail by the corporate system?
Yeah.
Is that severe?
Yes.
Are we in agreement that's severe?
Yes.
I'd say that's severe. Uriah Smith says, the expression, this is page 719, the expression, reward her even as she rewarded you, seems to show that the time for this message to be given and for the saints to be called out will be, this is the debate, when will this message be given? When is it to be given? Right? When are the people to be called out? Have you heard the debate? Some people have. I know we've got some heads nodding over here. Definitely heard the debate. So what does Uriah Smith say? The time for this message to be given will be when she begins to rise against them the arm of oppression. The arm of oppression. When the arm of oppression begins to go forth, according to Uriah Smith, and I believe him, I think he's got a point. When the arm of oppression begins to go forth, God calls out.
Yes.
You see that timing?
Yes.
In the 1828 Webster's Dictionary, it defines oppression as the act of oppressing, the imposition of unreasonable burdens, mm-hmm. either in taxes or services. Now, I would say taxes or lawsuits. Mm-hmm. I would say that would fall into that. Severity. Did we not just all agree that there were some things that were severe?
Mm-hmm.
The hand of oppression?
Mm-hmm.
So then, what does that mean? We're in agreement that the message must begin.
Yes.
The message must begin. And the message is to go out now.
Mm-hmm.
It is to begin now. We're not to wait for it to become this huge swell. If we know that the message is to be given now, then we should be proclaiming that message.
Yes.
Now. Not tomorrow. Now.
Yes.
Friends, I'm not pointing this out to point fingers of condemnation against any system, against any people. This message is given to us as a warning for us, so that we know where those plagues are going to land, so that we can be sure those plagues do not land upon us. That which she has done, double is going to be given to her. I don't want half, much less double. I don't want any of it. Come out of her, my people. This is the message that is beginning to swell. And I tell you, friends, it's not just against corporate Adventism. It's against all apostate Protestantism.
Yes.
All of them. For a long time, our voices have been overridden.
Yes.
But no longer. They're having to deal with it. They're having to contend with it. The more they have to contend with it, the stronger the oppression is going to be. The stronger the oppression is, the louder the cry will get.
Yes.
Who wants to be a part of that cry? I want to be a part of that cry. If you're willing to be a part of that cry, I would ask that you would kneel with me in prayer. Because we need the help of God to give this message. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We see what you have given to us in Revelation 18. Father, it's clear. It's powerful. And it's a bit scary. Lord, we cannot contend with this on our own. That is why it's scary. But Father, with you with us,
Yes. You
sending Jesus to be with us here, and the Spirit of Christ to be within us crying forth, Abba, Father, then nothing can stop us. Not because it's us, but because it's Christ working through us. Father, I pray that you will send Jesus, the Spirit of Christ, into our hearts, that you will empower us to stand firmly and boldly in love to proclaim the fourth angel's message. Lord, I pray that you will send angels that excel in strength to watch over and protect each and every one of us. Father, many people have committed to the proclamation of this message, and the devil does not like it. And so, Lord, I pray for protection for each and every one of us. And I pray that we will draw close to Jesus, because that is where our strength is.
Yes,
I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.